Microservices, it's a very broad topic, and we all know that application security plays a key ingredient in building robust, secure, good quality microservices, right? So I'm going to take the next 10 minutes touching upon few aspects in securing your microservices. So why am I talking about this, right? We know a lot of organizations are moving from monolithic applications into breaking them down into microservices in a big way. Unfortunately, enterprises still have the same kind of thinking with respect to security. Whatever they were thinking about building during monolith applications, they tried to apply the same thought process building the microservices. Application security is still an afterthought for a lot of teams that I've been working with. I'm going to just take a simplified example. This is an e-commerce example. I'm sure most of us in this room are quite familiar with this kind of flow diagrams. What I've drawn out here is an user agent. We have a bunch of microservices on the right-hand side, and we have a BFF pattern, backend for frontend pattern service, fronting the user request. So this is quite common, right? I'm sure all of us have seen this. So what I want to stress upon here is, whenever data travels between these lines that you see on the vertical lines that I've drawn out, the level of trust that you can have on the data changes, right? Sometimes it's explicit and it's very obvious, and sometimes it's not. For example, I mean, I would love to have a pointer, but for an example, when communication happens between, say, inventory service and order service, there is a good amount of reliability that you can have as compared to looking at the data that's received from a public internet, right? So it's important for us to understand, and this is what is called as a trust boundary. As per Wikipedia, it's a boundary where program data or execution changes this level of trust. So why trust boundary? Why should I understand trust boundaries in my applications, right? So it gives us a clear understanding of what services can actually start trusting which data that it receives, right? In our previous example, within a zone, if these services are interacting with each other, there is a good amount of trust that you can have in terms of validating the data, authenticity of the sender, and so on and so forth. And more importantly, data entering across these service boundaries need to be really vetted by the receiving service in terms of who is the sender and what kind of data, and whatever that means with respect to verifying the data. Now, not having this understanding of the trust boundaries, inevitably you see developers missing out on validating key aspects of their input data and process them, and eventually lead into a bunch of security vulnerabilities in the future. All right, so one thing to begin with, as I was talking about, people coming from the monolith world, they always ensure that any data coming from the public internet is vetted. Obviously, there is a user credentials, there is some authentication in place, so on and so forth. But to begin with, at least the services need to start identifying themselves with other services when they interact. So one key thing is to ensure that you have a service identity, service account, that you use when you interact with other services. All right, let's take a simple example. Now, let's assume this is an e-commerce example. So let's assume a user is trying to basically fetch the order that she placed a few hours back. So there's a call that comes to the BFF saying, hey, I am looking for order 1234, and I am Alice, right? What happens? The BFF turns around and calls order service, supplies its credentials, and gets the data back. So far, so good, right? What if this user has a malicious intent and says, OK, let me try and actually look for an order that I really do not have access to? OK, I'm Alice, and 9812 is an order number that I'm looking for. What do you think will happen? Most likely, I mean, speaking with some experience working with a whole bunch of applications, most likely the order service has no clue about the fact that this is indeed requested by Alice, and she does not have access to the order 9812. Now, chances are the person is going to get the data back, right? This is a problem. This is a so common a problem where when you have a whole bunch of BFFs fronting these services and they do not carry on the user identity, these problems happen. This is famously called as confused deputy problem. As per definition, it's a computer program that is innocently fooled by some other party into misusing its authority. Going back to our example, order service BFF happens to be that confused deputy, wherein it did not have any clue that this guy is trying to perform a malicious activity. Cool. As I mentioned, working with the teams, this is still an afterthought. Security is still an afterthought. So when people are faced with such problems, knee-jerk reaction is, hey, you know what, I'm going to add a validation in my BFF, saying when I got the order's response back, verify whether it is indeed matching with the user who requested it. Great, right? This works when you have a finite number of microservices in your organization. At least it plugs the immediate security vulnerability. But as you move, as you grow in terms of growing more microservices, more back end for front end services, you tend to find that you have started introducing duplication of this logic that is actually checking for the user and the data response. And the key thing is the domain logic is actually leaked outside of the domain, right? From an architecture perspective, this is seriously an authorization concern. And it is only better handled by the domain service that is responsible for order resource in our example. The reasons being, the order service has a good information, good knowledge about who is indeed asking for this data and on which user, on whose behalf is this data has been accessed for. Cool. Let's go back and let's talk about how would we have solved this problem, right? Great, same thing. Alice requests for order 1234. But now, when the BFF turns around to the order service, it not only passes on its authorization, it also passes on the identity of the original user who intended to look for this data. So now, order service has a good knowledge about who is calling and on whose behalf it's been called. Awesome. So now that we have stressed enough that authorization is a key thing for every microservice that you build, how do I approach authorization? I have tons and tons of microservices in my systems. How am I going to approach it? Yeah, there is no silver bullet. One straightforward thing is have a centralized approach, wherein you have some kind of a gateway of sorts, which basically filters out all your calls into the services, can perform some kind of an authorization at a very coarse level. API gateway, for example, is a classic example. And a lot of your cloud providers pretty much give you these facilities, right? So the cool thing there is individual services are not anymore concerned about having to implement authorization. But keep in mind, this can only be done at a very coarse grain. When it comes to rich domain logic and verification that you got to do on the request, then it's going to get really complicated. Of course, decentralized. This basically means every service implements its own authorization. So the developers hand code the authorization into the code base. It's a good thing because it's a domain specific information, domain specific constraints, and it's a great place to be to go and code that. But keep in mind, if a microservice developer or the team forgets to think about authorization, you are opening it up for future security problems. So yeah, that needs to be kept in mind. So I've seen another pattern wherein there is an authorization as a shared service or a shared library that is implemented within the ecosystem, wherein the definitions of these policies can be maintained centrally, but the autonomy of having to do domain-specific validations can still rest with the individual microservices themselves. Having said that, again, complex domain policies are easier said, but when you're trying to extract them, abstract them as a shared service, it can really get expensive because you're trying to generalize a very domain-specific problem at the top level. So as I mentioned, there is no straightforward silver bullet in solving an authorization, but as you evolve, as your organization evolves from like a couple of services into multitudes of services, you got to think about authorization and what approach, what model works for you. Cool. Just to summarize, understand your trust boundaries. Watch out for the confused deputy problems. Make sure you differentiate the user identity from the service identity. And verify, weigh the merits and demerits of various approaches for authorization. And more importantly, have fun developing secure microservices. Thank you.